Good evening, everyone. Welcome. My name is Peter Henry. I'm Dean of the NYU Stern School of Business and a professor here in the Economics Department. On behalf of the Marron Institute and the NYU Stern Urbanization Project, I'd like to welcome all of you to another installment in our series of conversations on urbanization. Tonight, we're extremely pleased to host Ed Glaeser, a native New Yorker and one of the world's foremost urban economists. Ed is the Fred and Eleanor Glimp Professor of Economics at Harvard University, where he also serves as director of both the Rappaport Institute for Greater Boston and the Taubman Center for State and Local Government. Joining Ed this evening is Paul Romer. Paul is university professor here at NYU, professor of economics at Stern, and director of both the NYU Stern Urbanization Project and the Marron Institute. The Marron Institute is a university-wide initiative on cities and urban management. And as I learned recently from Paul, the Marron Institute is also fortunate to count Ed amongst its external advisors, and also pleased to announce that Ed will be visiting us next academic year for a period of time as a distinguished visiting faculty member. Just briefly, Ed's work in economics touches on a wide range of urban issues, including crime, segregation, housing affordability, carbon emissions, the determinants of city growth, and the important role that cities play in the transmission of ideas. For anyone interested in understanding the power and potential of cities, Ed's most recent book, Triumph of the City, is essential reading. His recent working paper, A World of Cities, The Causes and Consequences of Urbanization in Poorer Countries, will serve as a starting point for this evening's conversation. Touching on themes from this paper, Paul and Ed will take us wherever they want to take us, which will be interesting, no matter where they take us, it always is. And the forces driving urbanization in low and middle income countries, I'm sure, will be among the topics they'll want to talk about. So without further ado, I want to turn it over to Paul Romer and Ed Glaeser. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Peter. So tonight, Ed and I will talk till about 6. At about 5:50, you'll have a chance to write some questions down on some index cards. Those will be collected, passed up to me, and I'll use those cards to guide the last part of the discussion. If you're interested in tweeting, our handle is at NYUSternUP for your urbanization project, and the hashtag is RomerGlaeser. We'll also we'll be filming this tonight, so eventually we'll have a version of the talk on the website if you want to review the highlights and revisit the high points of the discussion.
My larger gaffes will be there for all eternity during the
highlighted for easy identification. So let's start with the most recent paper and this question of what's different about urbanization in the developing world right now. And then, as Peter suggested, it'll go pretty much anywhere from there. But
so when I think about the remarkable rise of an urbanized planet, I think in some sense the most amazing thing is the fact that we have such an abundance of very poor, very urbanized countries. If you go back to 1960, there was essentially no such thing as a country with a per capita GDP less than $2,000 in modern dollars that was highly urbanized. To be poor was to be rural, which had been true throughout almost all of history. This is no longer the case. And I think there's several things that are going on simultaneously. On one level, it's reminding us of the extraordinary power that cities have to transform lives and society, provide pathways out of poverty into prosperity. That's something that cities have long had. But it's also, I think, a sign of a relaxation of constraints which previously stopped urbanization from developing in poor places. So if you think about the U.S. didn't become 50% urbanized until the 1920s, when our per capita incomes were about $7,500 in modern dollars. You know, China reached that number when it was about $4,500. It's the same for Korea. Kinshasa, the Democratic Republic of Congo, is at 350, right, as it's careening towards 50% urbanization. Port-au-Prince, Haiti, is at $1,000. I mean, much lower levels of income. And one of the differences is that the U.S., historically, had to feed its own cities, had to have a degree of agricultural surplus, had to have a transportation network to move that corn, and that required a certain level of development. Port-au-Prince doesn't need to feed itself, right? You can have American ships coming in, bringing in rice grown in Mississippi. So that whole constraint of having the transportation network and the agricultural surplus, that's been eased. And on one level, that's a great blessing, because these cities can you know, exist on lower levels of income, can provide some prosperity, some possibilities of it at least. But on the other level, it creates enormous challenges, because there are incredible downsides from density. right? If two people are close enough to exchange an idea face to face, they're also close enough to give each other a contagious disease, right? And, you know, cities have been trying to deal with these downsides of density for 3,000 years. And with enough prosperity, with enough income, with enough good management, you can deal with almost anything. But where does that leave Port-au-Prince? Where does that leave Kinshasa? And that's very much the challenge of the 21st century, is how to make these cities, you know, livable as well as prosperous, and to make sure that the right answer is not, you know, remain in rural poverty, but rather to have, you know, mega cities in the developing world that are humanly livable.
Yeah, we, you know, I think we're in agreement that the interesting development now is urbanization with much lower levels of government capacity. That's what really stands out in the developing world. And I think we also, in things we've written, we agree that globalization is a key part of understanding this. One part of that is trade in food, but the other part that Brandon and I have been emphasizing a bit more is flows of technology as well. And so both of these can play a role in this, but whatever the mechanism is, the challenge is to deal with and understand cities when you've got very low levels of governance. One of the things I've used in talking to students as well is this idea that one way to think about what a city does, or just bringing people together does, is increase the variance of possible outcomes. Just a lot more things can happen. So it's like a variance spreader. If you have mechanisms that prevent the negative consequences of density, the negative downside of that variance, then variance is a good thing. It's all upside. So it's one way to kind of walk a somewhat more nuanced line between urbanization is terrible, urbanization is good. It's like, well, it can be good, especially if you can present the downsides you're talking about, and then let it all those positive upsides emerge.
Yeah, I agree with that. I agree with that completely. And you know, I mean, I think that the few historical cities that did exist that were large, right, do really, I think, make this point. So if you think about Rome, right, 2,000 years ago, you think about Baghdad in the era of the Abbasids, right? These cities existed at per capita incomes of about $1,000, but they existed because they were the capitals of large empires, and they existed because they were the centers of governmental organizations that were able to conquer vast areas of territory and then move products around, right? So Julius Caesar could actually deal with the traffic problem in Rome by just banning wheeled vehicles for the first 10 hours of every day, right? Good luck getting that done in Kinshasa, right? Yeah. Good luck making this level of work. And another way to think about
this. Or good luck imposing a congestion charge in New York City.
For sure, right? I mean, thank you, Sheldon Silver. Oh, let's exercise that one. Right, exactly. And, you know, it's one of the lowest hanging fruit, actually, I think, for these policies is getting a congestion prize in Beijing or Shanghai now, right? This is the time for China to start imposing these prices.
But so, a way to make this the facts striking is to look at low levels of income and then high levels of urbanization. But the really interesting phenomenon is low levels of government capacity combined with high levels of urbanization. And I think trade is part of that, but also these flows of technology. So you're getting some flows of technology, like most strikingly in health, where it doesn't take any local government capacity to get big improvements in health. So we're seeing a lot more convergence in health outcomes, like life expectancy around the world, than we're seeing in something like GDP. It takes more government capacity to fully utilize the technology that's around in the world. And urbanization seems to fit somewhere in between. You can create an urban center and it'll be congested, maybe unsafe, high levels of crime, but you can still do that and get some benefits from urbanization with relatively low levels of government capacity.
Right. And one of the areas where this shows up is, of course, the rise of the tech sector in India, right? As opposed to traditional manufacturing, which depends upon having decent roads and decent infrastructure, tech, you can have in a campus that's relatively internally closed. You can have your own electricity generator because you can't rely on the outside stuff. So it's more tolerant of the weaknesses of the public sector.
Yeah. Which suggests something that you've written about recently that I think is very important, which is that you can take some of these services, like electricity. In principle, you could privatize that and let the private sector do it. And so if you're in a world with very limited government capacity, I think one of the things that you can do is think, what are the absolutely essential things that the government has to do? And then what are the other things that you could basically outsource? And even if in a world like the one we live in, where capacity is abundant, it might be more efficient to, say, like manage municipal water at the level of government. In a place where government capacity is very limited, you may want to decide, we're just going to have a private sector solution on water and then focus on mobility or crime as these essential functions that the government has to manage.
The problem with the privatization side is if there's something that actually requires a public subsidy or public regulation, these public sectors with very low levels of capacity are really bad at actually monitoring the private provider. So this is the history of public-private partnerships, and I think Eduardo Engel of all economists has been best at this, where Chile is quite capable of actually handling public-private provision of roads. They're a relatively competent public sector. Once you go to sub-Saharan Africa, you either have these stories of the private providers essentially subverting the government, bribing the government, or the government just expropriating the private providers, and the whole thing breaks down. And of course, we have this history of water provision in this city itself, where this combination of Aaron Burr and Alexander Hamilton together, came up with this scheme to have a private water provider that would handle New York's water provision that would be subsidized by the ability to run a bank. And of course, this didn't work very well because this entity did a lot of banking and not a lot of private water provision. Of course, today it's JP Morgan Chase, which was the Chase Manhattan Bank, which was the bank of the Manhattan Water Company, which just sort of reminds us that in our own past, we have examples of relatively weak public sector provision that sort of fails to solve hard social problems. Yeah. But that being said, I think there are lots of areas in which you really just want to give up on the public side and have the private providers take care of it.
Yeah, unfortunately, that even to make the PPP thing work or some other form of private provision, it takes some government capacity, but it they could do better perhaps if they don't try and run the water company, but at least run something like the Utilities Regulatory Commission to create conditions where you actually get efficient, or at least relatively efficient private activity. I was teaching yesterday some of these issues and was describing how interesting the city is as a way of reframing this familiar debate that we have at the level of the nation about the state versus the market. And I was describing this phrase, which I thought I invented, about there's no libertarians in the city, just like there's no atheists in the foxhole. But I told my students that even though I think I invented that, I apparently stole it from you. So
it's all right, right? Rahm Emanuel stole the Christ is a terrible thing to waste from Paul, and that's a far more important piece of verbal theft. Yeah.
But the irony, of course, is like the early part of my career was all about ideas which everybody can use, and there shouldn't be any property rights on them. So
that's right. And that's of course what makes cities great as well. And that's part of this technology transfer in cities is the ability of density to enable people to be intellectual magpies, to steal from each other.
But this phenomenon of basically shutting down the debate about do we need a fairly active government, one that we can still have at the national level, at the city level, it seems pretty clear, even for somebody like you, who tends to be, a little bit less sympathetic to the role of the state. But in the context of the city, there are these things like just managing the public space for mobility and preventing crime, maybe some aspects of public health, where there just isn't any demonstrated solution other than something collective that looks like government.
For sure. I mean, it's just an idiotic view to sort of take the view that you don't need a fire department. Yeah. You don't need somebody to worry about unclean water. It just isn't a sensible conversation. Right. We can have a sensible conversation about whether or not New York should have fewer land use regulations. I'm perfectly happy to stand with the libertarians and arguing for doing a little bit less, even more so in Mumbai. But I'm not gonna argue against public health infrastructure or public safety.
But one of the places I find this crazy debate goes is when people start to talk about private policing, I remind them about the problems of private policing, which we see over and over again in university-run police forces, where the university-run police forces systematically deviate from equal protection under the law to protect student athletes who often are predators vis-a-vis other students. So the track record of even nonprofit organizations running private police forces is really not very good. So at least in policing, there just isn't any solution we know other than some form of governance. But then you get back to the problem in the developing world, where the form of governance you've got is pretty weak. Systems of accountability are not good, and you get to some of the specifics that you've addressed on how we manage urbanization in the developing world and how we deal with things like crime. In some cases, perhaps just tolerating relatively high levels of crime and having relatively weak government because the costs of a police force that can, say, extract too much are just too high.
I mean, there's a trade-off between dictatorship and disorder that becomes more severe the more limited government capacity is. I mean, if you think about sort of the world of Rio's favelas, right, where you have a world in which private violence is extraordinary, but in many years, you know, the leading form of victimization that people reported in surveys was being expropriated by the police, right? There are no good solutions to this problem, right, at least in the short run. You've got a combination, you've got problems with the enforcement, you've got problems with private violence, and you almost assuredly have to accept that something will be bad and then work in the long run towards a better government. Yeah. I think one of the points about cities I think that's really crucial is that, you know, you may be tempted to sort of look at Kinshasa and say to yourself, boy, this is just awful, it would be better off if we didn't do this. Yeah. But certainly I think the right view is that we build public capacity, we build civil society through cities. That in fact, if we think about the sort of history of how indeed we get, you know, a movement to democracy, how is it that we get engaged citizenry that connect with each other, there's not a lot of that I see in highly dispersed poor rural communities, right? It comes out of a variety of urban movements.
Yeah, yeah. I think this is a point that the, you know, the political scientists and the nation builders haven't paid enough attention to, that the city might really be the place to think about developing this capacity for governance. And historically, things like public space, protecting that. I think that may really be the first step towards establishing private property, yeah. Which is that you first define what's public, and then the complement is the private stuff, and you protect that public space from things like the squatters. And historically, an incredibly important transition for all human societies was one away from basically the cycles of revenge that were carried out by clans or groups, that there were ways to deter violence. A movement away from that kind of system towards an institutionalized form of basically punishment for violence. And that transition, I always thought about that as just like this critical phase change in human history. But reading your most recent paper, it emphasized for me that transition happened in cities. That wasn't nations that set about to do this. It was really cities,
that's right,
which confronted with anonymity, so that reputation and revenge and my clan against your clan wasn't a very good solution. Cities had to come up with this other, more formalized system to manage this problem.
Yeah, I agree with that. Although it is still remarkable the extent to which, on the prevention side, not on the vengeance side, that private justice rules are still important. So, you know, the reason why when you walk into a Mumbai slum, you feel safe, and you don't feel safe when you walk into a Rio favela, is not because somehow or other the police of Mumbai are so superb that you feel completely protected by them. It's because the social structure still works. It's because there are eyes on the public spaces, and they come out. Now, I don't think they're engaging in vengeance, so I don't think they're doing, but they are at least on the prevention side, it's a community that protects itself in the way that Jane Jacobs described when talking about New York City 50 years ago in you know, neighborhoods very close to right here.
Yeah, yeah. This gets at some deeper questions. If you really ask, what determines this capacity for governance? This is really one of the oldest and most important questions in social science, and we still don't have a good handle on it. But there's some vague notion we have some intuition for about legitimacy, that governance is partly based on a perception by the citizenry that the government is legitimate. And it's got to exercise its powers in a way that preserves its legitimacy, and you know, we see this I think every day in questions about policing, for example. That this is at the heart of this debate right now about stop and frisk in New York City and the change, because as somebody pointed out, you could argue that what happened in the most recent election was that the city voted out a set of policies that had been very successful in the police department. People wanted crime down, and crime has come down, and yet the city, you know, voted out the people who'd been responsible for some of those policies. And I think the right interpretation is that people wanted crime down, but they also wanted the police force to behave in a way which preserved and reinforced the sense of fairness and legitimacy, and that had been undermined. And so now they're trying to figure out here how to reestablish both low crime and legitimacy. But if that's tough to do here, you know, it's incredibly tough to do in Kinshasa.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And it's, I mean, much of this stuff has its origins in Bratton's experimentation 20 years ago, right? So if there's someone who can figure it out, presumably Bratton is the right person to do it. But again, it comes down to this trade-off between dictatorship and disorder. And in some sense, the move towards very heavy-handed policing in the last, you know, 10 years was a sense on the part of voters they were willing to put up with all sorts of loss from the public side in order to have safe streets. And you know, on one level it succeeded marvelously. I mean, I was just remembering as I walked around here how different this area was from when I was a kid in 1975, right, where I certainly didn't feel that walking around Washington Square was something that was an absolutely joyful, risk-free event. Now it is. But it's happened at a horrendous cost, and a horrendous cost in terms of just the illegitimacy, the discomfort of being stopped and frisked for ordinary people. I mean, we've involved millions of Americans in the criminal justice system, imposing very large costs on them and the people that that care about them. And I think it's appropriate that we're asking whether or not there are ways to keep the city streets safe that are, that don't involve those costs, because it certainly wasn't free.
Yeah, and if you go back to this question about collectively deciding, perhaps, to just accept higher levels of crime, one of my interpretations of the equilibrium in Greece is that people who still, in living memory, have this experience of a system of authority that was used to disrupt the political, decision processes because of the experience under the colonels, people decided that it was risky, so risky to have a powerful state and a powerful police force, that they've really kept policing very weak, and that it means they've lived with extremely high levels of corruption and dysfunction. But you could interpret the structure in Greece as a decision that if you can't have an accountability structure that can guarantee you don't have a repeat of the colonels, then maybe you just live with a weak state and live with the consequences of the corruption that follows.
The flip side of this, which I it's a hypothesis I've never tested, is that they are also more tolerant of the disorder of riots in Greece, precisely because they have the memory of rioters acting against a dictatorial regime. And I think we often, Americans tend to be far less tolerant of rioters being somehow or other for the good when they disrupt ordinary life than do people in other areas where they sort of remember rioters being the heroes, whether or not that's Brazil or Greece.
Yeah. There was I can remember being in Athens on May Day. It was probably 5 years ago, and saw the big demonstrations from the labor movements, relatively peaceful. But then there's this fringe of the kind of anarcho hoodlums or that we use the pretext of the large demonstration to then just engage in violence. And the form of the violence there was you threw Molotov cocktails and tried to burn up a policeman, and the police were basically trying to just dodge the Molotov cocktails, but were very careful about responding with force, because a couple of years earlier, when they had actually killed a student in a violent confrontation, that had provoked even much more extreme demonstrations. So the remarkable thing when you're there is how restrained the police are and how much disorder they tolerate. And as you say, it's not something we would tolerate at all in North America.
There's also an interesting, there are a number of interesting things about rioting and the quality of policing, just a couple of things that are worth emphasizing. One of the things that's really interesting when you think about styles of policing is to compare the difference between New York's response to the Occupy movement and Boston's. So both New York and Boston's modern policing are children of Bill Bratton, right? He was there actually at the beginning in both things. Boston's approach tended to be much more community-centered about leveraging social resources. In New York, it involved to be a much stronger broken windows policy. Now, I'm not going to argue that there weren't differences on the ground that made those different choices optimal. The New York was actually a harder problem to solve. But you ended up having a Boston system that was very oriented towards getting people in the neighborhood to drop a dime, I believe the expression is, on other criminals, which was very helpful in the Occupy Boston movement. Because basically, as soon as people started occupying, the BPD were buying coffee for the guys in the movement. And they were actually making friends and subverting them, and it was time to shut them down. They just left because they had such strong social ties with the police officers. This is not at all what happened in New York, where it had much more of a confrontational style. The other thing I think that's somewhat interesting to note, to give the positive side to New York, at least one version of the positive side, is that there's a comparison that's often made between the riots in Paris in the banlieues in comparison with the riot that didn't happen around the Democratic National Convention in New York, which is often given to show the power of just mass prevention in the New York case versus selective enforcement ex post. So the New York process involved probably not so legal, but temporary incarceration of vast numbers of people, just clearing the streets temporarily in terms of, you know, which worked relatively well in terms of creating safety. Whether or not it, you know, ran roughshod over civil rights is a different matter, but there wasn't, you know, there wasn't long-standing bloodshed, there wasn't. Whereas the French pursued this very Gallic, you know, vengeance tradition of, they didn't, you know, they were going to go after each person with the full might of French justice and make sure that they were punished for their activities. Yeah. And I think it reminds us that in many cases, you know, just temporary incapacitation is far more relevant than actually engaging in deterrence. And actually, and I think that's an area in which our Chicago heritage probably misleads us. That in fact, thinking that punishing the people is really important is probably not right. Where you, in fact, you just want to make the streets safe in the short run.
Yep. So there's both, if, especially for riots, this issue of this strategy of incarceration, but also for deterrence. You know, the good thing about the economic approach to crime, which came out of Chicago, was that you really can deter bad behavior, and it's a really important lesson. I think the thing that was misleading was that we tended to think that increasing the probability of a punishment or increasing the fine or conditional on being caught were roughly equivalent. Yeah. And I think the evidence increasingly is suggesting that relatively small punishments combined with very high probabilities lead to both very effective deterrence and don't have this problem of the loss of legitimacy that can come if a few people just at random get hit really hard with very severe punishments and large numbers of other people don't get hit.
I think that's exactly right.
Yeah. And you know, this strategy you're describing in Boston is, I think, what the department here is now trying to do under Bratton. I mean, partly because of his, he was an advocate of the community policing from his early days in Boston. They didn't really have much chance in his two years at transit and 2 years as the commissioner to implement that community policing strategy here. But he did it effectively in L.A. when he was trying to deal with gang violence. And they're now actually relabeling this collaborative policing, because community policing got a little bit of a kind of a bad reputation. But I think the most effective way I've heard this described is really very close to what you were saying, is that you think about somebody who's got a close friend who's been shot, and the question is, what are you going to do if your close friend has been shot? Are you going to go out and take revenge yourself, or are you going to go to the police? And two key things that will determine whether you go to the police are, one, do you think they're competent? Will they actually do anything? If they're not competent, you got to take action on your own. But two, you also have to feel like, in some sense, they're on your side.
Right.
So like when I teach this, I tell my students, look, suppose you're a French family and your good friend has just been killed by some other Frenchman, but you're living under, you know, a Nazi occupation. You're going to go to the Nazis and have them punish the bad guy, or are you going to do it yourself? And so the department here is very focused on this notion that they have to be competent, but they also have to be perceived as working for the community, or the community isn't going to come to them and ask them to and help them stop the bad behavior.
Yeah. No, I think that's right. It's just worthwhile emphasizing how far we are from that ideal in so many of the developing cities of the world. How far we are from this model in which you actually trust the police to actually look after your interests and effectively get it done.
There was a police chief who gave me a good survey question to test for this, which is to ask parents, if your children will be alone, who do you tell them to call if something bad happens? And in most cities and most of the developing world, you don't tell your kids to call the police if something bad happens. You call a neighbor, you call a friend, but you don't call the police, because there's too much risk of the kind of thing you were describing in Rio. So,
absolutely.
Let's talk a little bit more about if this capacity constraint is the fundamental constraint, what kinds of things could we do to increase capacity of governance? We don't completely understand it, but we've got some intuition for it. You know, I've got a kind of a dog in this fight. I've been describing this recently as increasing exports of government services. Mm-hmm. So first we had exports of physical goods, then we had exports of private services like insurance, computing. But we could think more about exports of government services from places that are good at something like this to other parts of the world. And it raises complicated questions about accountability. But if you think about it as a kind of a subcontracting arrangement, you know, it seems possible that a country which wants to have privatized water, doesn't have any capacity for regulating utilities, could just contract with somebody like the Brits to actually use their experience in utility regulation on site, and then let the private sector operate. So I'm kind of trying to raise the possibility that we start to think of exports of government services as the next frontier in trade.
You know, various NGOs can be said as having done this, right? So mm-hmm. various watchdog groups exist in the developing world that in some sense are exporting government. But I think you have in mind a much more ambitious kind of agenda in terms of large yeah. scale, scaling this up. And indeed, yeah. it's exactly what you'd want, is some sense of, you know, an independent entity to check on a private water provider or a road builder. The problem is, of course, that the public sector often has a strong interest in not Yep. actually letting that work, right? That you actually don't want whatever corrupt dealing is going on with this water provider. The last thing you want is, you know, some pain in the neck Brit watchdog to be overlooking and saying that you yeah. that you've done it yeah. done it wrong. But it's hard for me to imagine. I mean, I sort of yeah. you know, many of these things have to start with a strong person in the center, right? I mean, a Lee yeah. Kuan Yew who actually yeah. has the incentive yeah. to actually shift everything, and it's harder if you don't have that.
Yeah. Well, one other thing I think we could look to is the possibility that even if many cities are not well governed and there's this equilibrium that's involves special dealing and cronyism and so forth, if there's competition between these cities, you might get a leader somewhere who sees that moving to the efficiency frontier, doing the thing that could actually make everybody better off, could be a successful strategy. So, you know, particularly if you think of the biggest countries of the world, so China and India, the United States, Europe, if it can achieve more real mobility, we might start to see more active competition, literally by people voting with their feet, and that might create an opening for a few leaders to pursue a strategy where they really try and ask, how could we bring in more effective governance, even if it's going to disrupt, you know, existing patterns of corruption and influence, because the overall gains will just be so large.
I think, I mean, certainly the competition among U.S. cities has been a big asset, I think, in pushing for good government in many ways. And I could imagine this playing out in China as well. I mean, China has many possibilities in the next 20 or 30 years. Some of them are very bright, including, you know, competition among effective cities competing with competent local governments to make things better. There's certainly a possibility. There are, of course, much darker possibilities for China as well. India has this challenge, which is local control, at least outside of Delhi, right? So there's a famous New York line in George Washington Plunkett's reminiscences to Reardon, right, that New York is pie for the hayseeds, by which, of course, he meant that those guys at Albany had been robbing New Yorkers blind for decades and preventing them, you know, from achieving their good. Well, if New York is pie for the hayseeds, I don't know what Mumbai is for Maharashtra, but it's far worse, mm-hmm. right? Because in fact, the underrepresentation of Mumbai voters in the Maharashtra state legislature is enormous, and the degree of local freedom there is very, very limited. So the ability of these cities to actually have this, you know, vision, I think, mm-hmm. does require some sort of differential institutional yeah. arrangement. Now, Delhi has this, right, by having a relatively independent control. Yeah. And then, of course, there's another issue, which is that many developing countries, precisely because of, you know, curious political past, the role of a single primate city is enormous, right? My work going back 20 years on this has argued that often these primate cities have political roots, that the tendency of dictatorial regimes or unstable regimes to channel resources to people who are close and hence politically powerful in a world without voting is just enormous, right? So, you know, if you want rents, you come in close to where the dictator leads. Having a Mexico City being dominated by Buenos Aires means that competition is going to be incredibly uneven starting at the... Mm-hmm. Now, you can imagine some competition among neighborhoods in these areas, but that's or you know, Jakarta. I mean, these sorts of areas are so imbalanced, it's hard to sort of... It's very far from the EU, US, China, India model where you right. can really imagine this competition among equals.
Yeah, even, you know, places like Britain, they're going to have a governance structure of London, which is much closer to the governance structure they have for the nation as a whole, because it's just so important for the nation. But I think there's a chance that India, if it solves this problem of creating local powers somehow, they could come up with a form of governance at the city level, which looks quite different from the structure that we're familiar with at the national level. There might not be the same checks and balances that you have at the national level, because there's another mechanism that's more more effective at the local level if you've got this competition between cities. So for sure. India might do this, China might do this. And it would be interesting to ask, how did the US get from this equilibrium where the states had all the powers to the point where the cities actually had real power? Because that was the same transition India has to make. And one of my hunches is that this kind of very active competition between, say, you know, Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York to become the premier port in the US, that competition must have been part of why the state in New York was willing to give certain powers to New York City. And that maybe what we need to really get those new powers to cities in India is to free up this kind of racing that will give states an incentive to make their cities more effective.
I agree with that, but it's sort of one of the things that's somewhat interesting is that historically, American agricultural areas were pretty rich, right? And this goes back to where we started this conversation, right? Yeah. That in fact, you needed agricultural prosperity in the US in order to have urbanization. So, I mean, by the time Plunkett was writing, certainly there was a gap. But in much of America, you know, the rural farmers who were, you know, thinking about Chicago were not sitting in an area of abject poverty dealing with the center of wealth. They had plenty of their own wealth. They were the birthplace of the American high school movement. In, you know, India, the gaps in wealth between, you know, rural and urban India are enormous. So it's always going to be very tempting for those, you know, representatives of agricultural areas to view this as a golden goose to be robbed. And I think that's a challenge that
Yeah, and I also think that to turn around the other way, that we were very scarce. People were very scarce resources in the United States, and they had good opportunities out on the frontier. Mm-hmm. So that if you wanted to be successful as a urban development enterprise, you had to offer a pretty good deal. Yeah. So the cities were not only competing with themselves, but competing with the frontier alternative, and there was a relatively restricted flow of immigrants across the ocean as well. So they may have been particularly conducive environments where competition meant that urban residents were offered a relatively good deal. And part of why I've been focusing on this extremely rapid rate of urbanization in the developing world is that if it's a sign of the demand for spaces in urban areas, then we've got this problem that you've got a relatively restricted supply and this enormous demand, the deal that's going to be offered to the potential new entrants into these cities is going to be really, really adverse, or much less attractive than the kind of a deal that emerged in the United States. Yeah, so we may not be able to achieve the same kind of political development or progressive developments that competition between cities led to in the United States, because they were competing over a relatively scarce good, and that's just not what we're going to see in the rest of the world. It still makes me think, though, that anything we can do to increase the supply of spaces in cities is going to help, because the bigger the imbalance between the demand for life in cities and the supply of life in cities, the worse it's going to be for the disadvantaged.
Absolutely. I mean, there are other things that we haven't really talked about that seem very important for thinking about. I mean, one of the things that was associated with sort of the slower urbanization that happened in the West was that we could think about cities as being relatively permanent things, where structures, I mean, if we look around us, there are an abundance of structures that are 100, even 150 years old, right? When we think about the developing cities of the poor world today, it's hard to think of any structure that you're building for Kinshasa today that will be appropriate in 30 years unless things go terribly wrong. Because without you know, unless things go terribly wrong, they will be 20 times richer in 30 years than they are now, which requires a whole sort of thinking about cities as being a very transitory process, of structures as being transitory. And, you know, as we've talked about elsewhere, sort of having something that's in place that allows for that regular evolution without huge amounts of disruption, that doesn't sort of build in, you know, we're going to be fixed by whatever we do now, is really, I think, crucial.
Yeah. And you know, I've been pushing on, one, this idea of like kind of exports of services, but two, this idea of starting new cities, partly because my sense is that managing very rapid growth in the area and population of existing cities is a tougher problem than actually replicating at kind of sort of some standardized scale by creating new cities. And I think the rapidity with which the price of land is going to go up, the density is going to go up, implies that these governments, which already have challenges dealing with the current environment, they're going to be even more severely challenged in managing the change that they're gonna face in the coming years.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, it also argues for different technologies, right? So, for example, the more you value flexibility, the more you presumably like buses relative to trains, right? So, if you think you're fixed within a particular spatial structure for the next 100 years, then by all means build the IRT, stay fixed with it. If you think you've got very little idea of what you're going to do, then bus rapid transit starts looking much more attractive because it scales up or scales down. I mean, one of my favorite sort of symbols of urban flexibility is the use of shipping containers as retail, something that is being done by Tony Hsieh and Zappos in Las Vegas, or Christchurch did it in the wake of the earthquake, because they put a lot of retail in these temporary containers. I'm not actually advocating containers as being a large-scale solution to the retailing problems of the developing world, but symbolically it sort of suggests the importance of recognizing the need for flexibility and the need for not permanence. And if anything, it even also reminds us that in many of these areas you want to think about development ultimately as being led by human capital even more than by physical capital.
We're one of the things we're trying to do in the urbanization project, which is focusing on the developing world, is bridge this big divide that exists between traditional urban planners and economists. And this is partly over the economists conceding there's an important role for the state, but from the urban planner side, I think they need to recognize that there's a dynamic character to these cities that mean you can't plan for a static outcome. You have to plan for a process. And the market is more frequently the process that will adjust adaptively as things emerge. So that I think one of the hardest things in arguing for some degree of planning is plan for optionality, not plan for a specific kind of outcome.
Which is the beauty of the grid, right? I mean, the grid has proved to be a remarkably flexible thing. This, 203-year-old plan in New York for actually reshaping the city as need be, but still keeping the connections open.
I like to remind people that when I tell them about the grid, they had absolutely no idea what we'd be doing with it right now.
That's right.
They had no idea what a car was, but they figured we'd do something useful with this all of this land. And Alain, who I refer to as a recovering urban planner, who teaches me much of the perspective on this, is helpful in just reminding the basic facts. Like 30% of the land in Midtown is in sidewalks and roads, and that's not even counting the parks. So that there is this enormous fraction of the land that they set aside to create possibilities that we're still taking advantage of.
Right, and think about the sidewalk deficit in the developing world. I mean, this is one of the great tragedies of sort of developing world megacities, is that it's just very difficult to walk around. Right, I mean, I don't know a better means of. I mean, I'm fundamentally not a public transportation nut. I'm fundamentally a pedestrian nut. Right, it's my favorite thing about New York is walking blocks.
That's your hidden libertarian.
That's my hidden libertarian thing that I like ultimately just to be on my feet. But that requires investment. That actually did require a public investment. That required putting down the grid, and it's just incredibly important.
This is something that in the urbanization project we're really trying to pitch to these developing cities, is they can replicate the kind of experience of New York City, and use the fact that they know they're going to expand into undeveloped land right now as a chance to protect this public space, and precisely do it to keep their options open. And the hard sell is, there's this kind of economic, instinct, which is, we'll let the market solve it. And, we know in the developing world that doesn't work very well. The planning side is something like, we'll plan the streets, but we'll also plan how big the buildings are and, what the floor area ratio is and what the activities are there. And that's not even on in the places where they have relatively large capacity for governance. In the developing world, it's just not even conceivable.
And the track record of, taking the prevailing wisdom in the developed world and then just grafting it on to the developing world with no thought of local conditions is just awful, right? I mean, if we think about the sort of history of 1.25 average floor area ratios in Mumbai, right? Unbelievably restrictive rules about preventing density. Right? This comes out of, you know, a British tradition of garden cities and imagining these, you know, wonderful, you know, English communities, and that may have been entirely appropriate in 1915 in the UK, but certainly it's not appropriate for India. India, you know, now and probably not for the next 60 or 70 years. And I think there's also, I mean, if I think about the sort of twin things on the physical side, the twin dangers, both in the developing and the developed world, right? One is NIMBYism, right? One is this tendency of, you know, whoever gets in there to fight anything, any other change that happens, which has the prospect to be even more dangerous in a world that actually needs to change radically than in a world where it's reasonably, you know, set. But the second is monumentalism. And those two things are connected, right? I mean, the monumentalism is also tied to the strength of architects. And there's nowhere where I see this sort of more strongly than in Shanghai, where if you look at the older Bund area, you see a marvelous urban space built around walking streets, built around tall buildings that are connected with each other, that are providing joy for people on a Friday or Saturday night. They're out there dancing in the middle of the space. It's just what you want a city to be doing. And you cross the river and you're in Pudong, and there are these skyscrapers going up. And look, I like height. I'm you know, long been an advocate of eliminating, you know, barriers to building up. But it's not height that's connected. It's height, it's proud towers, you know, representing monuments to the architect's skill, not to actually how human beings really connect with each other. And it's created a much more of a, you know, it's a monumental city. Of course, Beijing is even worse, right, for understandable political reasons. Yeah. But the whole thing is a city of monuments rather than a city of connected buildings and urban spaces.
Yeah, I taught in Shanghai this fall and lived part of the time in Pudong and then part closer to People's Square. And Pudong really is unattractive on the ground. You know, as a pedestrian, if you like to walk, and I've gotten this bug. I didn't have it when I was in Palo Alto, but since I came to New York, I've gotten this bug. And then when I went to Shanghai, it was really very disappointing. But you know, you hope, you cross your fingers and hope that they'll find some way to retrofit, you know, better sidewalks, a better, you know, pedestrian experience there. Yeah. But at least they have the space to deal with, because the roads are relatively wide.
Yes, they do.
If anything, they have too much space, so it's not part of why it's not an attractive pedestrian environment is the roads are so wide. But you know, they can, as you know, as Mayor Bloomberg showed, you can fix the problem if the roads are too wide.
Yeah.
You just turn roads into park and, and park and plaza.
Yeah.
What other developments catch your attention around the world right now? So there's kind of weak governance in the developing world, rapid urbanization. I personally think policing is increasingly going to move up on everybody's kind of radar as this critical function of government. And one other I think is actually air pollution. Air pollution is a health hazard. So not not just, you know, carbon emissions, but particulates. So those are kind of very big issues that I think we're going to see all over the world. Any trends that grab your attention?
I mean, air pollution is big. I mean, it tends to be bigger in places that have natural geography that is bad for it. So, for example, areas that have thermal inversion problems, like Santiago, is a big deal. It tends to be a particularly big issue around both, you know, getting vehicles to be modernized and paving streets, right? Those are two very natural things, as well as the sort of deindustrialization of the cities. And I think that's something else that, you know, it's connected both with air pollution, but it's also something that, you know, when we think about China, much of its urbanization is being relatively well managed, but it will also face the same deindustrialization that America's cities face. I mean, cities are just bad places to manufacture ordinary goods. Yeah. Right. None of the urban advantage of the 21st century, which is fundamentally enabling human beings to get smart by being around other smart people, of enabling the flow of ideas across cultures and civilizations, is shown when you're trying to create a lot of similar plastic products. Right. That's just not good. And another way, a factoid that I like about this is that, you know, when Henry Ford was starting out, the amount of square footage per manufacturing employee in the U.S. was about the same as the amount of square footage in other industries. You know, let's say 200 square feet per person. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at GM factories, it's 10 times that. Right? They've gone to a where, and that's just the rise of capital intensity in production. That, of course, means if you have 2,000 square feet per employee in a factory, there's no way that that makes sense to put in an urban area. Mm-hmm. Right? So, of course, manufacturing has, you know, it exists in the U.S. It's actually still thriving. It doesn't employ a lot of people. Mm-hmm. It probably will never employ a lot of people again, and it does employ a lot of space. That will surely repeat itself in China. right, where I don't at all expect that China will become an industrial weakling in the future, but it will almost surely emulate the U.S. process, which is that it will go from having a very labor-intensive process in cities to have a much more capital-intensive process in suburban areas. Managing this transition is going to be a big deal for them.
Yeah. And so you could have a phenomenon where manufacturing becomes a kind of a suburban phenomenon, still in a big metro area. I've wondered if the pattern here in the United States has been so heavily distorted by basically regional differences and things like right-to-work laws. So we have presumptions about where manufacturing is going to go, which is basically more rural states, which also tend to have, you know, something more like a right-to-work provisions. I could imagine in China manufacturing becoming a suburban activity. But it doesn't have to move out to, like, you know, the far west.
No, there's plenty of space before then, and certainly it's Tom Holmes's paper, which is the classic paper looking at counties on opposite side of right to work boundaries, showing the tremendous difference in industrial employment in the right to work states relative to the other ones. And yeah. I think that's exactly right. I mean, the other thing that's important, of course, is how the highways will be handled, right? I mean, the other part of the suburbanization of manufacturing is the dominance of trucks relative to rail. Now, you know, the U.S. has significantly subsidized its highways. Highways are part of the urban decline of the 50s and 60s. The work of Nathaniel Baum Snow at Brown finds that each new highway that cut into a metropolitan core after World War II reduced the central city's population by about 18% relative to the metropolitan area as a whole. It's unclear how, in the long run, you know, China and India will handle this.
Yeah.
And it's also true, of course, that in fact the U.S. rails are actually looking quite healthy in terms of moving goods, right? We are in fact a world leader in having relatively good goods moving rail yards at this part, in part because we moved out of the people moving business of rails. Yeah.
But presumably everything that travels on virtually everything that travels on a train here also starts on a truck and ends on a truck.
Yeah,
I mean, often it's
sure.
just with the, you know, sure. with the container sure. itself. But you know, if you look at the mobility patterns in cities, this old radial pattern where everything comes into the center is just yeah. completely gone. So even if they get very good with high-speed rail, even for freight, they're going to have a much better developed truck or some kind of point-to-point system sure. for each end. And they're going to need that for transit, for mobility of people, as well as for goods.
I
agree. One of the things I've concluded, having lived in New York City now, is that taxis are a very important complement to the public transit. That, mm-hmm. you know, you can't, like, if you compare Paris with New York, one of the problems in Paris is you just don't have nearly enough taxis. And so you can't count on getting around in the same way without a car that you can here in New York. So,
yeah.
So even, you know, this is like your point about, at least that I learned from you, about how the internet connectivity or electronic connectivity is actually a complement to face-to-face interaction, not a substitute. I think in the same way, certain kinds of, you know, car traffic like taxis can actually complement public transit rather than be a substitute.
Yeah, I certainly agree with that.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. And we haven't even talked about zip cars yet. As far as the. I mean, that's an open question as to whether or not these. While you're looking at these things, I'll just, you know, how these other. So the technologies associated with the workplace. Right, and I think the big story on that is that these technologies, which were allegedly going to cause, you know, an end to face-to-face contact in the cities that enable them, that hasn't happened, and that by creating a more globalized, more technologically complex world, they've increased the returns for actually connecting in person. Because the more complicated an idea is, the easier it is to get lost in translation, and the higher the returns to innovation actually make locating in a city more. More valuable. But there's also this question about what about the technologies that actually connect with urban living? So Zipcar being one of them, right? Which on one level, so Zipcar pitches itself as this, you know, rise of the sharing economy. Now cities have always been about sharing, right? Mm-hmm. What is that thing out there, Washington Square Park, other than a shared backyard,
right?
Yeah. It's been about for 200 years, right? What is a restaurant other than a shared kitchen and a shared dining room? This is part of what cities do because we're crammed into one place, we share things. Yeah. Now, of course, Zipcar couldn't exist when I was a kid in New York in 1975 because someone, the guy before you, would have like left something awful in the car for you to deal with. And you'd hope it was just a mess, not like a dead person. But, you know, either one was possible. Now with, you know, technology, we know who the last person was and we're possible to share more. But it'll be interesting to see moving forward. I mean, there also were earlier technologies like, for example, movies and television, which reduced the urban advantage of having live entertainment. So there was also an era in which these other things changed.
Yeah, but I, you know, by the way, for a subsequent conversation we'll have, you know, my early work was all about ideas as the fundamental source of increasing returns. And I think that's not enough to understand cities. I think there are a lot of lumpy things that that we share, so physical things, not just ideas, that mm-hmm. we share that are part of urban agglomeration. Mm-hmm. So like the airport, it would be a good example. There's something about the physics of planes that means it's just much better to have a bunch of people fly at the same time. And then if you're going to go to some place where you can fly, you know, unpredictable times in one of those big planes to a lot of different places, you're going to end up sharing an airport. There's just no physics-based solution that lets everybody have their own airport. So so sharing of these lumpy physical objects, I think, is part of the foundations of this increasing returns that drive all of this agglomeration. And it's an interesting question how to model that. We've modeled it indirectly as something about plant size in a bunch of these models about urban agglomeration. But I think it there are many many other applications like airports that go far beyond the plant.
New York's origins is its port, right?
Yeah.
We are here because of this port. Right. And the early example, of course, of what you're talking about is the rise of the packet lines, the Black Ball Line, which starts here in 1819, which is precisely the rise of ships that sail, right, on a fixed schedule,
right?
And in fact, you need a certain amount of scale to make that possible because you need to have enough people that you get these what we call statistical returns to scale, so there's a reasonably good chance that you're going to be reasonably full on that Friday when you depart, as opposed to the previous method, which is you just have the guys sit there and wait for you to take off. And presumably you could have that in low density areas, but to have this regularly scheduled stuff, you need the scale to iron out the rough. Yeah. And just same thing with ready-made clothes. Again, a New York thing. Again, it requires statistical returns to scale because you're going to make a bunch of clothes in different sizes and trust that they're going to, the randomness of human sizes are going to average out. And that's, I think, one of the reasons why New York becomes the pioneer in prêt-à-porter stuff.
Yeah. So let me just list a couple of these questions. So one is, how does the hukou system in China prevent a healthy housing market? Or I think we can expand it to, how does the hukou system undermine all kinds of aspects of urban development there in China?
Hukou bad? I don't know. I think there are lots of reasons to like the freedom to move across places. You've discussed the relationship with sort of political independence and political pressure, which is true. But even more so, there's just the basic human freedom of being able to move where you think you will have a brighter future that gets turned off when you're going to have internal passports. Now, luckily, at least the Chinese have their own way of basically allowing people to subvert it. But it still ends up with an underclass in the cities who aren't able to enjoy any of the primary political benefits. So, I think this is clearly
I think it's bad because it creates the wrong kind of incentives for competition between cities. And it's bad because it creates this kind of institutionalized unequal treatment under the law. And that has, I think, subtle but really pervasive effects on the quality of governance and accountability. One of the things, Shenzhen is my new favorite city in the world alongside of New York. And one of the things that struck me about Shenzhen is that almost nobody has hukou there. Mm. So because it's entirely a migrant city. So it's basically equal treatment under the law because nobody has hukou. But
now there's an interesting political thing, which there are two obviously rival political dynamics going on with hukou. One of which is the desire to cater to the empowered insiders, the nimbyists, if you will, and not expand it. But the second thing is it's got to be clear to the CCP that the hukou outsiders are a potential, powder keg. Mm-hmm. That this is actually a group that could be profoundly destabilizing in their major cities. And that, I think, has got to lie behind the sort of murmurings that we've heard about reform in various places. So again, as in the case of China, there are many different paths forward, some of which are bright and many of which are not. But
I think one of the interesting lessons about governance management is, one, the importance of measurement and then incentives based on that measurement, and then two, the risks of getting good at it. Because, if you don't have it, you can't get people to do the things you want them to do. But if you, as we know, some things are easier to measure and to create incentives for, and then you can get a lot of activity, some of which is good there, but you get a distortion where you do less of the thing that you're not measuring versus mm-hmm. the thing that you are measuring. And this is, of course, a lot of the debate in say, measurement and incentives around public schooling. But my interpretation of where the hukou system really developed was that they rewarded the mayors based on a measure of GDP. they didn't give them the resources to pay for things like schooling. And so what mayors responding to the incentives created by the Communist Party did was try to attract migrants to increase GDP or gross output. Mm-hmm. But they didn't have any incentive to try and attract, say, new permanent residents. So it was a very different kind of competition than, say, played out in the U.S. But I think the central government is now realizing that this was the wrong way to create incentives, and that they now want to create something like the fiscal returns for attracting a lot of people and permanent residents, which could then create a much more balanced set of incentives for mayors, so that they want to attract permanent residents, they worry about quality of life in terms of air pollution. So I think there's some hope that they'll be able to unwind the bad incentives, but it came ironically, I think, from in some ways a system of incentives for local leaders that was relatively effective. They wanted GDP growth, and they got it. Here's a question for you. How much building up is too much?
Look, you know, it's important to note that it's not as if I've ever actually advocated for building higher when the market wouldn't support it. I've argued for fewer regulations restricting building, right? So it's not as if I'm an advocate of building, you know, subsidizing the building of skyscrapers. But I do think that we have almost assuredly paid too little attention to the downsides of restricting building up. I'm fairly convinced that, you know, New York could upzone areas around Grand Central Station without it creating a huge amount of cost for the city, that the lost value by restricting height here is, and obviously there are other environmental and economic benefits of doing that. You know, I'm not in any sense opposed to having appropriately designed impact fees associated with new building, as long as they're well designed in a way that captures the social costs of this construction. But it's
would you like set the impact fees to cover things like the transit?
Yeah, whatever we think are the appropriate infrastructure costs of building this. Now, it's true that in a lot of cases we have property taxes that already are designed to do that. So in some sense, it overdoes it. I mean, I would even when we're being bold, let's just say a word in favor of Henry George, since in fact there is a progressive wind blowing through. So let's say something positive about now Henry George, who advocated a single tax on land, was perhaps a little bit foolish to think that this would solve all of the social inequities of society, which it surely will not. Nor would I agree with him that it's appropriate to give up all other taxes, such as income taxes or other means of paying the government. But the basic principle of having a tax that is associated with the value of land, not with the structures that you put on top of it, has a lot to recommend itself, because by taxing structure, we put a strong incentive not to build up, not to provide more space. And in fact, you know, I mean, New York needs that space, and you know, moving towards a tax that's more a land tax than another way of thinking about it simply is, you know, you could just put a big fee on people who leave vacant lots in prime areas, who use vacant lots as parking spaces rather than building up on them, which, you know, is another way of pushing that dimension.
Yeah. By the way, yesterday what I was teaching was a case about the New York City Olympics bid, so the bid for the 2012 Olympics, that was led by Dan Doctoroff.
Dan Doctoroff, of course, yeah.
And the really interesting thing was that Doctoroff saw that the bid for the Olympics was the way to basically upzone a large fraction of the city, and also to do it in a way which happened in a bunch of different parts of the city and associated with projects that everybody was going to support, and that the value of this would be there even if they didn't win the Olympics as they didn't. So when you look back at the amount of the city that was upzoned under the Bloomberg administration, it was a very large number. And this device of kind of deadlines and coalition building and coordinated efforts, you know, clearly was part of how you got the rezoning in Hudson Yards and, you know, around the High Line, but you know, in the waterfront in Brooklyn as well.
Yeah. I mean, every city should plan for an Olympics, and none should actually get one.
Yeah, right. But to use it, you know, it may be a way to overcome the inertia and NIMBYism that often stops. Because a lot of these rezoning proposals and different, you know, reuse of the land had been around for sometimes for decades, but it took a kind of coordinated effort to get them done.
You know, you often need a story to generate upzoning. So you know, from an economist's point of view, inclusionary zoning, various forms of strategies that say, look, you need to set aside 25% of your units for affordable housing, are highly debatable, right? Because these are, in fact, taxes on development that can, under certain circumstances, reduce the amount of new construction. When I've talked to people who are involved in the administration of this, they will argue, in fact, that, well, look, if we hadn't done that, we would have gotten nothing through, that this was absolutely critical politically for making this happen. And I can't rebut that. It's a story that makes it clear that there is some benefit for affordability of building up. A similar story is Boston has an innovation district on the water, right, which was sold to Boston as being part of trying to solve the traditional problem of Boston being dominated by big, stodgy employers, right? This enabled Mayor Menino to upzone the area to get more building in a way that if it was just about, you know, development, it never would have happened. So I think getting the narrative across that says that, you know, we're not trying to create a handout for developers. We're trying to enable the city to adjust for the 21st century. We're trying to enable a change in the city that enables a more robust future, I think, is critical. And maybe the Olympics are part of that.
Yep.
I mean, I remain convinced that, in fact, one of the you know, arguments that will be most effective against various forms of NIMBYism are environmental, right? That in fact, Boston, for example, is dotted with triple-decker houses that are terrible from an energy use perspective, right? That is a powerful argument against the, you know, preservation of these areas in that would not be, you know, I could make this argument purely economically that people should be allowed to redevelop these, but the environmental argument, I think, will have much more clout in terms of the public debate.
So how would you counsel somebody like the new mayor here in the city about how to address questions of affordability? This is a big question. It's related to kind of questions about inequality as well.
I mean, the problem is, as we both know, Paul, is that, look, I mean, there's no repealing the laws of supply and demand. There's no answer to getting a lower price than building more. But it's almost impossible to imagine that New York will actually end up building enough housing so it will have a huge impact on prices, right? I mean, we're just so far away from the world of the 1920s when the city built 100,000 new units a year, right? Which, you know, if we started doing that, we could imagine something would really changing in the short run. But that is very far from where we are. So while I will always favor leaning against, you know, regulation and making more housing affordable, it's, you know, it's hard to make any claim that that's going to deliver much cheaper housing in the short run. I think I'm not totally closed to things that feel a little bit like inclusionary zoning. I think it's not inappropriate to lean a little bit on smaller units, on things that look a little bit less like 157 and a little bit more like, you know, large amounts of housing for ordinary New Yorkers. I'm not against luxury development. I mean, that eases the pressure to gentrify lower areas. But I think it would entirely be appropriate to lean a little bit more on production of you know, various forms of cheaper units.
I was at a forum with Amanda Burden, who would, you know, been head of the I guess the planning commission here in New York, and made this claim about how it increases in supply were really the only way to affect prices. And I think the polite way to describe her reaction was she kind of laughed me off as an ivory tower academic who didn't know anything about the real world, and I think in some sense that was probably fair. You know, in the world that she lives in, they can't do very much about supply, and they know that, and so they're stuck with thinking about things that have transfer elements to it, or subsidy elements, or symbolic elements, or diversity, but they, you know, maybe they're too cautious, but I think this administration tried harder than any and was more successful in trying to upzone, to try and increase population.
In Manhattan. You have to ask yourself about contextual zoning in the outer suburbs, right? Yeah. So there's contextual, there's I give them very high marks. I was ready to fight with them around upzoning around Grand Central, but the record is more mixed once you get outside of Manhattan. And particularly contextual zoning, which is basically down zoning via a different word, outside of Manhattan is something that you want to be, you know, it's a less pro upzoning.
Yeah. Your theory about why they were doing some of this down zoning at the same time they were generally trying to upzone? Was this just political?
I think it's political of various forms. But I think there also was, I mean, I think there's also a taste for traditional neighborhoods you know, I don't really have a strong enough view. I mean, Vicky has been my primary source on this, and I believe she's now relatively constrained in what she can say about these things. But the,
I mean, in their defense, I mean, the one thing I have heard is they really were thinking about transit-based developments. So they were trying to upzone around the transit corridors.
Yeah.
But it did seem puzzling to me about why you didn't just selectively upzone, but why would you actually you know, downzone?
And you know, you can make these points about supply in more, you know, I mean, I think Houston is not an academic place, right? Houston is not some academic myth. It is a place that has had enormous growth and is incredibly affordable. And so is Dallas, and so is much of the American Sun Belt, right? And these are places that remind us of the enormous power that supply can have. Now, this is not relevant for New York because, you know, the Isle of Manhattan is constricted in ways that, you know, Houston is not. But it is relevant in many other areas. I mean, you know, my own home county of Middlesex County, Massachusetts, is considerably lower density than Harris County, Texas, while having much higher prices. This is not an island that is constrained by water. This is a county that is constrained by thousands of myriad little local land use decisions that make it impossible to build. And it's remarkable that, you know, I've never heard of a Texas politician that actually cared about affordable housing, or at least said they cared about it, and yet they deliver it. Whereas our politicians talk about it constantly, and we had our state rep on the front page of the local paper with the state senator as well, because they had built exactly one affordable housing unit. That this was some sort of great triumph, was one affordable housing unit. And that's one of the things that I worry about, this sort of bifurcation between market rate housing and affordable housing, is that all of a sudden you get to give a pass on market rate housing because you've produced some number of affordable units, which isn't really solving the problem in any real way, because for most people who don't have access to this privileged stock, you don't actually have the ability to get there.
So let me close with just two ideas. One of the things that you know, you've emphasized all along is how powerful cities are as this place where face-to-face you talk to people and you get a new idea. From Matt Ridley, I stole his phrase about, you know, what happens, ideas don't replicate, they have sex. And, you know, what happens is you match these ideas together. So let me just describe two I picked up from face-to-face conversations with people. Taka Ito pushed me on the idea that the aging population is actually going to make cities much more attractive, because the transport opportunities where for people who don't have cars are going to be better in denser cities. So that was one thing I picked up from talking to him.
But safety is critical.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a traditional thing that pushed against an aging population coming into cities was fear.
Yep. And I think the reduction in crime has suddenly completely opened our minds to that. I never would have, 10, 20 years ago, never thought that New York City is a place you'd tell my parents to go retire and, you know, live in when they couldn't drive anymore. But now all of a sudden it's a real option. But so aging is one. And the other was Enrique Peñalosa pointed out to me, the former mayor of Bogota, that the United States is actually going to have a significant expansion in its urban population. And that makes us unique in the developed world. So if you think of, I think the estimate is about 70 million additional urban residents in the United States, and I forget the time frame, but where do you think 70 million people will go in the U.S.? Are they all going to go to Houston?
You could put the whole world on 10th acre lots in the state of Texas. It is true. I think it's probably is going to be dominated by Sunbelt cities that have a relatively permissive attitude towards new development. Not all of that is good by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, part of what I've always wanted is for New York to have a larger share of those people by enabling them to build more. But the number of bodies that come to a place is intimately tied to the number of homes that are built there, and there's no repealing
and
that.
And you've emphasized frequently the importance of like sun as a predictor of where the growth has been and where it will go. But how much of that is climate and how much of that is politics?
So we've done a bunch of decomposing this in various ways. So I have a paper with Nina Tobio called The Rise of the Sun Belt that does our best to use. So you can use a bunch of different pieces of information like prices and incomes and population growth to try and figure out how much the Sun Belt effect is about these various things. The key point is the Sun Belt rise can't be driven primarily by an increased demand for being in sunshine over the past 20 years, because if it were true, then prices would be rising faster than income. The basic logic of urban economics says that, look, if an area is becoming more attractive because of its amenities, it should become more expensive relative to, you know, how much you earn there. This you see nowhere more closely than in New York, where, in fact, real incomes in this city were significantly higher than else in other places in the nation when I was a kid here. Because you had to pay guys combat pay to live in New York in the 1970s, right? And today it's no longer true. Not because, you know, nominal wages have declined, not because people aren't earning perfectly high incomes here, but because housing costs have gone up so much more quickly. You know where you know housing costs have not gone up relative to incomes? In Texas, in Atlanta, in, you know, in these Sun Belt areas. And I think that tells you that a lot of what's going in there is that, you know, Atlanta, Dallas, Houston, and Phoenix each added 1 million people between 2000 and 2010 because they make it so easy to build. Yeah. Because you can just mass produce housing on an enormous level and provide, you know, and we shouldn't sneer at that. I mean, that's, you know, that's real quality of life for ordinary Americans, and that's something to admire. But there are also problems with that model as well.
Yeah. Well, I'll make my final pitch, based on the follow-up conversation we had on the phone, which is that, you know, if we're going to have 70 million new urban residents, it's conceivable that some of them could move back to Detroit. We've got to solve the crime problem. I think we cannot overstate how important crime is as a deterrent to city life. But it doesn't all have to be Houston and the Sun Belt. You know, there are places like, you know, Detroit. Cleveland, that if they, you know, if they got their act together, they could compete as well. So
sure, and there are certainly, you know, Pittsburgh, you know, there are plenty of places, including New York, which looked far bleaker than they do today. And this does happen, but sadly, Detroit still has more than a bit of way to go.
Yeah, so we don't want to give politicians a pass for producing one unit of affordable housing, and we also don't want to give them a pass because they're not in the Sun Belt.
You know, I agree completely.
If things don't turn out well, it's their fault.
So. Yes.
Thanks a lot.
Great. Thank you, Paul. Here.